Does my poverty upset you? Does my truth fill you with guilt? Does know from where I come, of the soul that hurt and abuse built? Through the streets and darkness, where crime and pain thrive, through the loneliness and hardship, I'm strong, I learn to survive. Does my nakedness shock you? I was not born to be clothed or fed. I wait for you and your pity all day. Cry myself to sleep on my concrete bed. I'm the child on whose life, to count your blessings, you were taught. Of parents, of love, of care, of affection, you have a lot. Yet you leave me alone to die, leave me alone to rot. Through the pain in being alive, I survive. Wishing upon a star for a chance to thrive, I survive. Waiting for your voice, your minutes five, I survive. Mukul and Kamal. There were two boys that were brought to an orphanage one day after another. On the day Mukul was there, the worker there was a Shah, so he was named Mukul Shah. On the day Kamal was there, the worker there was a Kumar, so he was named Kamal Kumar. Together grew up, brothers in a way, but soon they were 18 and it was time to leave the orphanage. They'd both studied till class 12, they'd both got similar marks and they both wanted to go to college. But Kamal got to go to college because he got a reservation, and Mukul, he got left behind. And so it went on. Kamal kept getting reservation, Mukul kept getting left behind. Today, Kamal is an employee of the transport department, and Mukul Shah is a badhai, a carpenter, in front of the very orphanage where he grew up. When I met Mukul Shah, he asked me, "Meri kya galti thi? What was my crime? Why was I a Shah and him a Kumar? Why was I not a Kumar?" And I had no answer to give him. Three kids in Delhi, all under the age of 10, living with their parents, so to say, but parents incapable of taking care of them. Father who disappeared, a mother who forgot to feed her children, not for one day, not for 2 days, but for 15 days, and they withered away, cruelly, slowly dying. When I was researching my book, I was in Rajasthan and I was at an orphanage, and I walked across the street to a dhaba. I was having tea and Maggie there, and there was a young boy serving me, nothing very unusual about him, except that he was speaking in very good English. So I called him and I said, "What are you doing here? Why are you working here?" And he said, "I'm from that orphanage and I got 96% in my SSC, but I don't have money to fill the form of admission to go to college. I'm working here so I can get some money." And he had no idea how he would pay for tuition. How many of you here have taken coaching when you were in 10th or 12th? See, how many of you here have parents who pay your fees? Or, you know, send you money every month or something. How many of you here have a family, a home, a place to go back to every vacation? How many of you here want, you know that tomorrow you will be engineers, that you will be entrepreneurs, that you will be business people, that you will do an MBA, that you will get into the IAS, that you will be part of the government, that you will do something with your life? That covers pretty much all of you, right? It covers pretty much every child in every room, in every college. But imagine being 16 or 17 and not knowing that tomorrow whether you will have a roof over your head, whether you will have food on your plate, let alone an education. Imagine that knowing that no matter how hard you work, no matter what marks you get, no matter how smart you are, the best you can be is a plumber or an electrician or a carpenter or a badhai or a laborer. That is the reality of 20 million children in India. 2 crore children in India are orphans, 2% of India's population. Together, they make a city larger than Delhi, a country larger than Sri Lanka. Let me take you on a slightly different path now. What do you think is the weakest animal on earth? Rabbit, a mouse, some kind of insect? No, it's not. A human baby is the weakest animal on earth. Because the weakest of weakest babies of other animals learn how to survive on their own within a few months or a few weeks. But a human baby without a parent or a guardian cannot survive for the first 4 or 5 years of its life. So a child which has been abandoned in a dumpster or thrown in a park is truly the weakest animal on earth. And without a support system, a society, a government to take care of them, these children are condemned to death. You know what the sad part of being an orphan in this country is? That you're not just an orphan because you have no parents. You're also an orphan because you have no government programs. You have no system. You don't have a society that takes care of you. There's only one government program for orphan children in India, and it covers less than 1 lakh children. Less than 0.5% of the estimated 2 crore children in India. And why do I say estimated? Because India as a country has never bothered to have either a census or a survey on the number of official number of children that it does have. Poorer countries like Chad, like Ethiopia, like Malaysia, like Indonesia have these surveys, but India doesn't. You know, they say adoption is a solution. But in the whole of the country last year, only 6,000 children were adopted. The planning commission in our country was supposed to, you know, guide our growth for 60 years. But the planning commission, out of its 12 plan documents, in 4 of them, the 2nd, the 5th, the 6th, and the 7th, they forgot to mention the word orphans. In the last plan document, the word is there in one place, and that is in context of residential schools. The total budget for orphans in this country is 1500 crores. That is less than ₹3 per child per day. This is less than ₹3 for food, for education, for clothes, for medication, for infrastructure, for salaries of staff, for everything. And on the other hand, the government of India gave 16,000 crores to Air India to stay afloat. These lack of funds have led to severe lack of infrastructure. 1 in 5 districts in India does not have an orphanage. And you know what happens to children in districts which do not have an orphanage? These children are put in hospitals or put in juvenile justice homes, which are children jails. Now you tell me, what do you think happens to a 4-year-old or a 6-year-old or an 8-year-old who has no family, no money, no prospects, and he is housed in a place where children with criminal tendencies are kept? What do you think happens to them? You know, as a country, it's not that we don't do for other children, for children that are historically considered weak, for social, educational, economic reasons, and rightly so. The government, the constitution does a lot. 7,165 crore rupees is given in scholarship to children of minorities. Scholarships to go to school, scholarships to go to college, scholarships to go abroad and study, microfinance, loan, everything. But if there is any child that is considered weak for any reason, how is a child thrown in a dumpster not weaker than these children? Do these children who are thrown in dumpsters not deserve the same kind of benefits from the government? The Mandal Commission made 11 criteria for any class of citizens to be declared OBC. Any class which qualified more than 50% of those criteria was declared OBC. Orphans is probably the only class of citizens that qualifies all 11, 100% of these criteria, and there's nothing for them. The Supreme Court gave transgenders reservation, and nobody gave orphans anything. And why? You know, people ask me why. And the answer is very simple. Orphans have no vote. There are hundreds of schemes for poor children. You know, from nutrition, midday meal, Kasturba Gandhi Vidyalaya, so many schemes because their parents vote. There are hundreds of schemes from children of weaker communities because their parents vote. Orphans don't have a voice. They don't have a vote. So they are lost in the system. But criticizing what governments have done or what they haven't done is not the solution. You know, I'm often asked, what is the solution? We are the solution. You are the solution. You are educated. You are studying in an engineering college today. You are empowered. Tomorrow you will go and vote. What if you lend your vote to these children? What if you lend your voice to these children? 4 years ago, when I was a student, I started writing this book on orphans. It's called Weakest on Earth. I traveled with my brother to 11 states and we went to 100 orphanages. And the stories we saw and the injustices we saw completely changed our belief in the system. We petitioned state governments after that. And then I put in PIL in the Supreme Court. I've asked for very basic things, like there should be orphanages in every district, that there should be a census for orphans, that if you give benefits to any other children, please give them to orphans. And if you give reservation to anybody, please give them to orphans. And it's not that change hasn't happened. Change has happened. Telangana has declared orphans OBC, so they get all the benefits of being OBC. Delhi has given them special provisions in education. Goa has given has promised to give them 1% reservation in education and jobs, something which Maharashtra has already done. The Jharkhand CM has recently put orphans and orphanages on his election manifesto. And more than any of that, since my petition, the budget of orphans was increased from 960 crores to 1500 crores. That's not much, but it's something. But that's all it took, you know, it took two kids writing a book, one petition in the Supreme Court. And that's all it takes. You can make that change. You can do it. You know, people ask me how to make this change, and it's very simple. How many of you in your, you know, birthdays or special occasions have gone to an orphanage to give sweets or do something? You know, lots of you, right? It's a good thing. But if a kid is in an orphanage, maybe they don't need food. Food isn't their most pertinent need. Next time you go there, ask them what they want. Maybe it's school books for the next year. Maybe it's pens or pencils. Maybe it's sweaters for the winter. Maybe it's just career advice. Ask them and you will make those children's dream come true. But it's not only about going and giving things. Sometimes just the act of going is enough. If you go to an orphanage, let's say once in a month or once in 2 months, you hold the orphanage accountable. You see that the funds the orphanage is giving is reaching the children, that they have beds to sleep on, that they are going to school, that they are being given proper food. If you are going there, you're holding them accountable. But sometimes, you don't even need to do so much. All you need to do is give 5 minutes of your time. Next time a child comes to you begging on the street when you're driving or you're walking, just stop and ask them. Find out if they have a family. Find out if they're going to school. Find out if you need to take them to the nearest police station or to the nearest orphanage. And just make that effort. Find out if you can write a letter and get them admission in RTE. And just make that effort. Your little effort will change their life forever. And sometimes even that doesn't need to be done. Sometimes all we need is your voice. When Nirbhaya happened, the rape laws of this country changed. But in Muzaffarpur, 34 girls in an orphanage were sexually abused for over 15 years. And nothing happened. We read about it in the papers and forgot. You know why? Because Nirbhaya could have been me. It could have been you. It could have been your friend, your girlfriend, your wife, your sister. It could have been any of us. None of us can imagine being an orphan girl in an orphanage. But imagine their plight. Imagine having nowhere to go for shelter, nowhere to go for food. And where you are being sexually abused day in and day out for 15 years. Our blood should have boiled. Laws should have been changed. But more than that, imagine if somebody like you, for example, you, was going to that orphanage like, you know, once in 2 months. Maybe you would have developed a trust with the girls. Maybe they didn't have the courage to go to the police, but maybe they could have told you what was happening. Somebody like you could have saved the life of those 34 girls. And somebody like you can. There are countless orphans, countless things to do. I keep saying, you know, there are 2 crore orphans, and there are 2 crore orphans, and there are 2 crore orphans. But one forgets, this country also has 120 crore citizens. If 2% of us, only 2% of us, take it upon our lives to change the life of one child in our entire lifetime, every orphan in this country will be taken care of. You know, you guys have bright futures. You will have careers tomorrow. You will have families. You will have fortunes. What if you promise yourself today that in your life, you will do something for one orphan child? You will not be able to change the world, but for that child, you will definitely change the world for him. You know, studies show that 25% of orphans commit suicide between the age of 18 and 20. At 18, when they are, you know, kicked out of orphanages with no resources, no money, nothing. After that, your little act of kindness can truly mean the difference between life and death for somebody. So please, raise your voice. Don't keep quiet. Join the movement. And together, because, you know, the system doesn't listen to these children, but the system listens to us because we vote. And together, you and I can be strong enough. Together, you and I can make enough noise so that the system listens, so that the government listens, so that the system becomes one in which every child is taken care of. Because these children deserve care. They have nothing and nobody. There is a very favorite poem of mine that I'd like to end on. It's from a Nobel laureate called Gabriela Marquet that says, "There is no greater crime than a crime against a child, because his blood is flowing, his bones are growing. He doesn't have a tomorrow, his name is today." Thank you.